Welcome to the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. I am joined on this episode by the other half of The Rejected. It's former Tri-Counties champion, tag team champion, and we're going to speak about his match for Abdi Anarchy because it got announced the same day as we're recording. It's Chris Archer. Welcome to the show.
Hello, sir. How are you doing?
I'm doing very well. It's take two. We're going to get through the whole episode, though. Thankfully, it was just the start because technical difficulties are just wonderful in this whole Zoom podcasting.
Well, I'm not a technical person.
No, it's like I say, I mean, even if something does happen and goes, oh, what can I do to fix it? I don't know. Just start it again. Hope for the best.
Turn it off and on again.
Yeah, that's how we get through it. Anyway, right. So first question is always the same with these things when it's the first time guest. It's very classic, very boring, very cliche. How did you get into pro wrestling? What was the moment that got you hooked on this weird world of wrestling?
It's weird. It was a mixture of kind of two things because I started watching wrestling probably about the age of six. So you're probably speaking 2000. So I remember getting a video from my uncle, I think it was, I would like to say. And it was like a generic best of Hulk Hogan or whatever it was. So stick this on. I was like, who's this guy? This is an ace. So I remember watching that, and he had a whole collection of just videotapes, just best of this guy, this, that, and it. And I remember watching, you know, I used to get the old double cassette, the video VHS box sets.
Yeah, I do.
Something. Yeah. So I got, I got one of them from him years, like a year or two later, and I remember watching that, and it was WrestleMania 4. And I was, I'm watching these guys, no, I haven't seen any of them before. I think, oh, they're awful. Check the size of him, obviously not knowing that what the current product was. And then my parents got Sky, so you start seeing guys like Chris Jericho, The Rock, taking this is probably the height of that, sort of the height of that, Judas. So you're kind of seeing all these different things. It's like just blows your mind. And so I kind of watched it regularly from then. But also I never, my parents never had the sports channel, so you're always getting. Maybe a couple of weeks, you get a couple of weeks later. So you kind of, you'd miss a lot of pay-per-views, but you used to get your friends that would record it or you know, they'd also say, oh, I'll give you a copy of this for a copy of this pay-per-view sort of thing. You know, but now I've been watching it. Thank God for the network. Now there.
Absolutely. But no, it's weird speaking in WrestleMania 4. That's the tape that I've got right behind me here in this cavalcade of crap. Those the one I took down. Ted DiBiase got him to sign it and everything. So now it's in the wall of stuff. I don't know how if it actually.
I only
works.
Met him. I didn't actually meet him. I was at a signing for the Piper, but I didn't meet him.
He was really nice the first time I met him. He was a dick the second time I met him. So you know it balanced out quite nicely for Ted DiBiase. So how did you go from watching it to discovering your local scene? Discover that or was it training
it was
first?
Kind of it was a weird one because my grandparents they used to go to the wrestling those years ago when I was like big daddy so that sort of era and they just happened to see a wrestling ad in one of the P&J or whatever paper it was and so do you want to go okay so it was I think it was I'm not sure what name it was but it was at Northern Hotel this would have been October 2009. So they took me along, watched that, and I thought, oh, I want to do this. Mostly, I was only 15 at the time. So I remember asking one of the later, like a show about a couple of months later, I spoke to Martin and said, well, how do I go about training? So you speak to Scott or you look up the school. So looks it up, gets in contact with the guys. 3 weeks later, that's me started, but it wasn't anything like it is now with the proper facility with the ring up. This is a completely different kettle of fish. Because back then it was just a scout hut with just mats on the floor. So these guys now don't realise how lucky they have it.
I keep hearing of this scout hut and how a bit destitute it was in comparison to this now a facility with a ring and a promo space and. All this kind of stuff that they can do now with it. But so when it came to that first couple sessions, then in this scout hut, was I mean, clearly you liked it enough to keep doing it, but was that first couple of weeks just the worst, or did you take to it quite quickly?
It was. I would say half and half, because you came in expecting a ring up, all this kind of things, and you come in and it's like, oh, so all you see is just these gym mats. So once you kind of got past that, I thought, you know, I want to do this, I'm sticking with it. And I had a friend that started the same week as me, but he only lasted another 2 weeks, and he just didn't want to. He liked wrestling, but he wasn't into wrestling. Mm-hmm. So he left, and weird enough, I always, for some strange reason, remember my third session. I don't know why it's stuck in my head, but you just did a, sorry, it was just the two of us, so you just had a mixture of things you were doing, like learn bumps, and I guess they all will learn strikes. So I think it was with Scotty Swift, I think I was doing it with him, me, my friend, and he calls Crusher over. So the first time you see Crusher, it's like, you know, he's a big guy. Love him to death now. One of our best pals in wrestling. But so he comes over, he says, oh, he's going to give you a club to the back. So thinking nothing of it. Puts him in position. Bang! It felt like getting hit by a brick wall. And I went back the week next week.
So quite glutton for pain. I mean, growing up, were you doing things like sports or any contact sports or martial arts or that kind of prepared you for it? Or was it just a case of just dive in and hope for the best?
I wasn't really a sporty person growing up, really. I did football for a little bit, but I wasn't really into it at all. So, you know, I was more kind of, I like getting into wrestling. And then I didn't realize how athletic I actually could be until more I got into wrestling, that I could actually do stuff. Apart from wrestling, I've never really been that sort of physical, like, sporty person. I'd rather just sit and watch a TV or play video games. I've always been that sort of person.
I'm a lot of daft things
since then.
Yeah, I was going to say, I'm the same, but I just stuck with the sitting on my arse and doing nothing. Anyway, right. So, yeah, had the first session. Third session, you got smacked by Crusher. All good. So, when did you actually progress to being in the ring? Was that kind of on show days only? When did you actually get a taste of the actual in-ring bit of it?
Well, I think at the time, your shows were only once a month. So you would obviously, that would be your ring time then, but even then it wasn't guaranteed, because some venues you wouldn't get in till 4:30, so it'd be a case of get in, set the ring up, you might have 5 minutes, you might have half an hour, you might have an hour. So you always brought your training gear with you, just an off chance you might get the odd 5 minutes. But a lot of time it was a case of turn up, set the ring up, and whatever your job was for that day. But they did try and make time on certain shows when they could. So they used to say the Northern Hotel, you'd get in at 12 o'clock, so get in, get the ring up by 1:30. So you'd have a good few hours in the ring. But like a lot of your, like, Banff, Bucky, or some weird and wonderful places, you literally would just get in, and that was it. Set up, gone. So you didn't get a lot of ring time, but what you did get, you'd appreciate, because you weren't guaranteed it. Mm-hmm. So nowadays, obviously, you're in pretty much every day if you want to, plus show days.
I think some of the venues, WrestleZone Run, like, all your time is taken from putting up the ring itself, because I've seen the Fraserburgh one especially. It's like, so tight, I don't know how you guys get the ring in. It's just ridiculous.
Very skillfully.
yeah. Same with Northern, really. I mean, I suppose they've got, must have a tradie entrance and all that kind of stuff, but still, it's not a wide venue. It's quite narrow in places.
The worst one was Macduff. Macduff was the worst. Narrow staircase, steep like that, narrow door at the top. Horrible. And it was old ring as well.
I remember my early complaints to WrestleZone was every time I had to go, I had to go upstairs, because it is, all the venues were just up steep stairs, and I was just, what was the worst? The worst one actually was the Mick Foley one at the Leisure Centre, because we got herded up all these stairs to meet him beforehand.
Oh, Matt Denny.
Oh, that was, there was some weird and wonderful smells I don't want to repeat in my life in those staircases. It was just horrible. When they changed it up for Anarchy and it just came through the entrance, I was like, oh, this is the best. I'm so happy now. So sad to go to a wrestling show, just be happy there's no stairs to go on.
It's a rare thing.
So you're getting these little venues in then, you're getting your bucket and all these, like I say, weird and wonderful places in the Northeast. When did you find out you were actually getting on a show then? Was it always Chris Archer your first match, or like much like when I spoke to Aspen, it revealed his first match was actually as Super Executioner. Was there any pre Archer days?
There was like I did do a couple of training matches leading up to it, but when I got to the time of being on shows, it was myself and that Zach Dynamite. We got asked, right, get gear. We think you're ready. So she said, you go order your gear, but it doesn't always come straight away. And I think we're in Banbury for a show. So I had my training gear with me, as you should. And so you got your boots and that with you? Yes. Right. Your sister for tonight. Said, what? Okay. So one of the few occasions I've had to do that. So that was an experience, to say the least. It's a mask. You need the head for it.
there's like nothing. Like there's no, your eye room is just nothing. Your mouth, you got very little. I don't know if anyone listening has seen a cysto, but go check out a cysto and you'll be surprised how anyone can just cope in that costume. But at least to give you a little bit of I don't know, working on a bit of personality, being able to get a crowd going, because that's pretty much all cysto needs to be, because you can't see their face at all.
It was a good learning curve, because it taught you the expressions, you know, because obviously this is what sells, this is what makes the money, not punching the guy, it's what they see here. Mm-hmm. And obviously that come, I was like 4 or 5 months later, I actually did have my first Chris Archer match against Crusher Crabe. You know, say clean shaven, young looking baby face Archer. Not this that you see now. But Chris Archer was kind of on and off for about a year. Because obviously you had that meant things already in place. You know, there wasn't the space to have him, because you had a couple of new guys just coming in, so there wasn't the space to have everyone in. Excuse me. And then I think it was 2013 when Davey Annan left WrestleZone, so they needed someone to fill his gap. Honestly, I was the only guy not doing anything. So they put me and Brian Starr together, and that was a thing for about 6 months. So that developed the character a bit more. Yes, you're on the opposite end, you're going to be in hated rather than liked. So that again was a different learning curve. But that did, you know, it taught you a few things, being in a team and having to work off of someone, work off all these different things. And it was mind blowing stuff when you weren't, because starting off, I wasn't the most outgoing person, never have been. Mm-hmm. What you see on a show is completely different, but that's just me turned up. But being with Brian Starr for that first few months, it kind of got you a bit more comfortable being yourself, being that character, kind of developing the character, eating into little things, you know. And eventually come time, I think it was end of 2013, we got split up and Chris Archer got his first singles run. And that was an eye-opener. That was definitely a big learning curve, if you know what I mean.
That's when I started proper getting, because my first WrestleZone show was Anarchy 2013, so the first big one at the ballroom. And then after that, I was kind of just enamored with WrestleZone, and still am. This is what, 9 years later, Jesus. It's been a while. But no, so go back then to your first run, and so 6 months later, you become Chris Archer. So that's 2012-ish. Yep. So you're coming into ring, well, you started when you're, so are you about 17 when you had your in-ring debut?
17? I would have been still 16 at the time.
That's quite nerve-wracking for a 16-year-old to be on their first wrestling show, and it's against, well, just anyone really with their face out there. I see some of the young guys, and I like your Evan Youngs and your Ronan Kings, and they just come out quite bouncy and confident. And I've seen some others that have debuted that hasn't went that way. So how did you feel like your first match with your face out there? How do you think it went?
It was absolutely definitely nerve wracking sort of thing, but there was a comfort there because I was in there with Crusher, so a guy I got on with, and I knew how he worked. I knew because he was a big guy, small guy, half your job's done, mm-hmm. you know. Well, so once you get in there and he starts hitting you and throwing you about, it's like, okay, I've got my work cut out for me. And always remember that first match because obviously. Match was what it was. Good little match. Was what it needed to be. Hits me with black hole slam. Bang. 1, 2, 3. I'm lying there. He grabs my head and goes, "Go back to school, boy." And this is the hardest I've ever been hit. And I've not been hard, hit that hard since. Catch me. Big slap right in the side of the head. Bang. I said, okay. I think I'm this is going to be fun. This is going to be a fun run. And that was... That was Chris Archer's just kind of on and off appearances for, I would say, that was 2011. So for about until at least end of 2012, Chris Archer was just on and off. So it wasn't, you weren't doing it regularly. You're kind of, you were doing other sort of characters or different things. So you kind of, you weren't getting used to just one character. You're having to kind of learn to do about 3-4 different things.
Yeah.
So it was a lot to take in at 16, 17. And I was just to have your head switched on, like this show I'm doing this, but this show I'm now this, or some shows you are both. Which I don't miss those days. I do not.
So like I was going through like obviously your cage match profile. That's my excellent research that I do. And I was noticing you weren't on that first Anarchy show, but Sisto was in the pre-show. So was that yourself getting in front of the ballroom crowd?
That was me for that one, yeah. So that was a strange experience because you didn't have the full crowd for the ballroom. So you could hear the crowd, but because the sound was traveling up, they sounded like a lot less. So you were maybe getting a reaction, but it didn't sound like that reaction because obviously all your sound's going up instead of kind of coming towards you. It wasn't a 5-star match, but for what it needed to be, it was good. It was fine.
I'll just put it out there that was my first ever WrestleZone match that I watched. It was yourself, must be Malice and Thunder, I think it was. So yeah, if I didn't like that, I mean, I paid for my ticket, I was staying the whole night anyway. But if I didn't like that, then I was going to have a sour note for the whole show, and it was like, This is great. This is just pure entertainment, and that's what I find. That's why I love WrestleZone. Yeah. It's their variety show. That's what needs to be. Yeah. That's why I like it. And Sisto does that. I'm not going to go pick out every Sisto match and go, "Was that you? Was that you? Was that you?" And all of them. Some of them clearly weren't you. especially when big Sisto number 2 turns up, but. Well, we'll leave that aside because if Adam's listening to this, he will hate any Sisto chat going further forward. So we'll leave it. One last thing, though. You said it was a big learning curve as Sisto because you're using your body language. Yeah, what was the heat like in that? Because it's a full body costume. There's no skin.
Oh, there's no room for breathing in that thing. Especially beach ball, you've got the stage light, so it might not feel like it when you're out there, but you would come back through, take everything off, and you would just have a cloud of steam. Some places you would wrestle, and you'd be in there, it's like you'd be dying. You'd literally be chugging water the whole time till literally you step through the curtain because it was that warm and that thing.
But it's a trial by fire. I'm sure many a first couple matches for trainees is the tangerine dream just to get them out there. I would reckon just from watching. But well, like I said, we'll move on from Sisto. We'll leave him on his own planet. Him, they. I don't know what the pronoun is for a Sisto.
It's he, them.
Yeah, I just He's the other gender. He's just there. I keep saying he. That's just because I'm old. So yeah, The Outcast. You mentioned that with Brian Starr. That was kind of your first thing outside of being off and on, being Chris Archer, appearing in random matches every so often. So, say a tag team thing. That was another big thing. So Brian would have been around for a little bit beforehand. He was kind of, I'm gonna guess, he was one of your kind of core guys in WrestleZone, and you were put with him. Which again, we see nowadays that there's not a change to the system in WrestleZone awful lot. It works. So yeah, tag team thing. You're Outcast. You got the matching gear. Were you just told get gear that matches, or were you and Brian quite close with working out how the Outcast operated?
I think I already kind of had the gear myself anyway. I'd ordered it, but I'd not actually ever used it. So when we got told we're getting put together, he said, I'll get gear to match yours. So he goes and gets similar gear. So he gets a match, similar singlet with a similar sort of logo. And we only ever had the yellow one, so we didn't have the black one. So I've still got that piece somewhere, but I don't know if they'll fit now. But so he gets the gear. And you know, we always just collect the big guy, small guy thing. So the dynamic worked. So I would be the guy kind of go in, do my little thing. As soon as the good guy starts firing back, I'm like, oh, tag out, you deal with him. And that worked. But yeah, I got through with him, so you had someone to learn off of, work of. That's a formula that works. And the same happened with me and Vago. You know, he got put with me because I was a more experienced guy in that side of things. So same happened with me and Brian Starrs. It was to give you someone to learn off of. At the same time, you weren't just getting shoved out there on your own. It's like, go do something, go learn. You always had that kind of person to kind of rely off of, you know.
Must be weird going from the guy put in that position where you're the young guy putting with the veteran, and then a couple of years later it's going, right, we've got this new guy, he's called Mickey Vago, you're going to be guiding him. You're thinking, oh no, I've only been doing this for however many years, 5-6 years, and then you're going, oh no, I'm the adult in this situation,
be grown up.
I know, and you're like half his age at the same time.
Sorry, Vago.
So, for, as we do this timeline, as I try to do as a professional, so to speak, match that popped up as I was going through this was April 2014. So this is just must be the tail end of the Outcasts, round about the kind of start of Revolution, against Wolfgang. So 2014 would have been ICW Fight Club documentary which came out that year. ICW was quite big at the time, and you get Wolfgang up in Aberdeen, and you're the one chosen to go against him. So what was it like did you feel you were ready to go against someone that was a bit more established around the country at that point, or were you just happy to be having a match?
It was a strange thing. I got told, because I didn't get told until the match graphic went up, and I seen that, I said, oh, okay. So you were nervous going into it. Yeah, you would be going against someone you've not ever worked with, and especially someone that has experience as he was. So we'll go into it, and putting the match together itself, so easy. So he would do what match we would do, come back through, and obviously there's guys who got a smile on their faces, you know, good job. And I'd actually just gone in there, just, I'm just going out there, do my job, do what I've got to do. And you watch it, you know, so we'll go watch it back. I said, that was really good. Well, what happened? But you know, I was a massive learning experience with Wolfgang, because I would have ideas. He said, okay, we'll do this, but we'll try it this way. You know, usual sort of thing. And but putting that match together was so easy. But what a size of guy, obviously, because at the time I was quite skinny, and just anyone could just pick me up and throw me about. So I did take a lot of bumps for that match, from what I remember. I've not watched it back in a couple of years, but I did pretty take a lot more bumps than I would do now.
Yeah, fair enough. But yeah, we see his matches with like Solar and what have you. So he's definitely used to working with smaller guys, and I don't think there was many folk bigger than Wolfgang then. Anyway, Crusher maybe would have been the only other guy around the country.
Yeah, I think working with him was, as well, you had the big guy, small guy dynamic, but it was the other way about. So it wasn't like the massive bad guy versus the little good guy. It was kind of the opposite way around. So that was your first sort of obstacle to try and get over. And obviously, once you actually get him down, it's like, what can I do? Because I'm not going to pick him up and slam him or pick him out and gorilla press him. But so it kind of it made you think. But as a match, I do enjoy watching back. If I do get a chance to go watch it back, but I've had that much matches, you can just pick and choose. Just I'll watch this tonight. But I stopped counting how many matches I've had now. I don't know what it's sitting at now. But.
I mean, it must be, you've packed in quite a lot in the course of like 10 years. So it's not a surprise, especially with things like gala days and all that kind of thing where you'd be wrestling six times. Just as yourself, and then maybe doing another couple matches in a mask as well. So it's weird to think that you were like kind of the bit part guy. Because like I say, when I came in, you were just about the outcast has just kind of started. So I've always kind of known Chris Archer was in WrestleZone, kind of thing. So you had the outcasts. It was finished. It kind of petered apart or split, and then you were in Revolution briefly with Johnny Lyons and Damien. So it kind of worked because being the outcast, wanted to revolt, all kind of worked together. Weird thing was like Johnny seemed like the really odd one out in that kind of group, but we'll get there. What was it like? Do we just kind of grabbed that we need this three group, or was it just because it was the build to Anarchy that year with X-Pac, and how did Revolution come by?
I think I think it might have been a mixture of a few things, but it was kind of the build up to Anarchy. That was must have been the match that they wanted to have. And it just not seem to click because we were three different guys, but it did work as one sort of unit. But each guy had his definitive sort of style. Mm-hmm. But it worked as a team. But it was only ever meant to be get to Anarchy, and then Damien and Johnny Lyons was the team. I was just that sort of third guy. But that sort of time period from, I would say it must have been a month, 2 months before that Anarchy, until just after that, kind of turn sort of Chris Archer into what you have now with the bandanas and the massive, massive, massive collection of bandanas that I now own.
Well, we have questions about bandanas coming. Don't you worry about that. So yeah, Revolution, it went to Anarchy next year, 2014. In one of the marquee matches. So you went from the pre-show, not Chris Archer, to now into the sixth man against, at the time he was still Dave Patterson. He wasn't Mr. P just yet, but it was Dave Patterson, Scotty Swift, and X-Pac against Revolution. So again, you've went from, like I say, the outcast, literally, because you were kind of just plodding about to get there. And then you had your match with Wolfgang, and then Revolution came by. So the year after, same year. So it's quite a, you've went from just about on the cusp of just on the outskirts to now in these matches. What was it like working with X-Pac?
It was a weird one because when we first got shown what matches we were having, it didn't sink in straight away. You just got told, given the list, this match, like Johnny Lyons, Chris Archer, Damien versus Dave P, Scotty Swift, X-Pac. You kind of think about it. Okay, is this real? And obviously, as the weeks went on and on, obviously, you're filming these promos, you're going out doing these, obviously, seeing the posters and all this kind of thing. It slowly started to sink in, but it didn't actually sink in till I would say we're actually standing in the ring and the lights went down. That's when it clicked. It's like, oh, this is real. We'd met obviously before the earlier on in the day, but it wasn't after that whole time period. It wasn't until literally the lights went down, and then it's like, shit, this is real. But even to this day, you still don't believe it. You watch earlier match or you see him just on things online. It's like, I've wrestled that guy. No, I've wrestled this guy. It's like, it still doesn't seem real. Obviously, I've been lucky enough to be in the right place at the right time, I suppose.
Yeah, I mean, between yourself and, when I was speaking to Vago about his kind of Anarchy collection of matches, it's insane what matches you've kind of ended up with or cropped up in during this time. But I was speaking to, like, so seeing X-Pac, you're you kind of got into wrestling at the Attitude Era, so perfect. Scotty Tuhati, X-Pac, great. Were you a bit more excited to see Hacksaw Jim Duggan the previous year, though, because you started in with the golden age, your 80s, early 90s wrestling. Was that kind of, when you met Hacksaw, was that your, like, dreams made?
When we did South, we used to do signings, like, the thing, probably 2 days before Anarchy. So we're in, must have been the old schoolhouse, so they assigned trainees to, obviously, to work with the guys that just had your little sticky yellow notes, you know,
yep.
This guy's getting autograph, this guy's getting photograph, this, that, and the next thing. So Mikey Innes gets put with Billy Gunn. Obviously, you can get stories from him about Billy Gunn. And they ask, well, you can go with Jim Duggan. So that's cool. So work with him, hand him the notes, right, doing my job. And so he sits down to have food after, and so just yapping away. And he hands me his book. You know, she opens up, signs it. So she did it to the Hall, Jack, so Jim Duggan, Hall of Fame 2011. Just handed him it for nothing. Because they were, that following day, they were going to do a media day to advertise Anarchy. So he leans into me and he says, "Hey, kid, I need someone to throw about in this thing tomorrow. You cool to do it?" Yes. Yeah, no, yes, no worries, Jim. So that, yeah, and TV's Chris Archer became a thing. So that was a running joke for a while. So we go in, and the footage is somewhere. I don't know. I've tried to find it. It's somewhere on Facebook land somewhere. I'm sure someone somewhere has got it saved. But so that was an experience. That was fun getting thrown about by him. Actually, you've seen Jim Duggan. You hear him before you see him.
He's just one of those imposing guys, because I met him that year and it was just like, oh my god, you're a lot bigger than I thought you were.
He's one of the few guys I've seen, because not all the guys you'll see are as big as they are on TV, but Jim Duggan, Billy Gunn, obviously Mick Foley are guys I've met that are bigger than I thought they were when I would actually met them. But funny story about Jim Duggan, on the Thursday night, I bought him a couple of drinks. Obviously, nothing. I was just buying him a couple of drinks. And Dennis leans into me. He said, "Are you buying that off your own money?" I said, "Yeah." He says, "No, use the company card. No, you shouldn't have to be paying it yourself." So 2 days later, Jim's just getting ready for his match. He's gone over everything. He's just warming up. And he comes to me and says, "Can you go get me two double vodkas and Diet Cokes?" So I look at the time and thought, a bit early, but okay. Hands me his money. I go to the bar, get the drinks. So I think I went back and got another round after that. Then he goes out and has his match. But early in the day, he actually comes to me and asks me for a bottle of vodka. I said, "Jim, I don't have one, and I'm not going to go get one." So yeah, and end of the night comes, and he hands me this. Must have been, I don't know how much it was. There's a heap of change. Hands him in the hand. He goes, "There you go, kid. That's yours." So I had a couple of drinks and Jim Duggan.
Nice. Lovely guy. How much change you're going to get from the ballroom bar? If I learned anything from that place. Jeez. I think I got robbed for a Red Bull once.
I was fine. He was half cut by the time he went out. But Jim Duggan, you can't tell if he's drunk or sober. Lovely guy. Uncle Jim. Miss him. Lovely guy.
Hopefully, touch wood, hopefully one day we'll get him back, you guys get him back over, because it's just, I always like the hospitality that I hear about from, obviously, this side of the barrier, that you get the guys in a couple of days early, and like I say, you put a trainee with them, they get to learn, they get to look after. If they balls that up, then they're not going to have much shelf life after that, but, you know, it's just ace. And I know people listen to this or read anything that we do and think, oh, you just bum up WrestleZone so much, but it's not difficult to do. That's why. It's not like I'm finding things to praise them for.
It's just, look at that. It's a lot of guys, it's not so much like when they come in, the reason I think they get them in is a couple of days, it's not a case of come in, do the show, and then that's it. It's like you give them that day or two just so they can kind of climax, or so you can time difference and everything else. And if they want to do a bit of sightseeing or just to chill out before the show day itself, because obviously you know yourself, because sometimes when you go, especially, well, they're used to kind of wrestling every night. It's nice for them just to kind of come in, right, I'm wrestling Saturday, but I've got Thursday, Friday to just switch off, unwind, and just, I think they appreciate, because they're not just getting rushed into this, like, here's a sign in, here's your match, right, here's a plane.
Yeah, so like I said, it's just so easy to praise you guys. It praises the whole roster as well. It's just ace. So Revolution, you had a match with X-Pac, and then from that point, there was a wee weird period where you had the old Shawn Michaels Diesel kind of dynamic with a wrestler I don't think we can mention after the events of June 2020. So we'll kind of, although Crusher has asked a question, so we'll just throw that in there. We're going to speak about the Dogs of War into the Rejected in a second, but Crusher Crabe has asked, do you wish you could dump Mickey Vago to take back the Alpha Male?
No, thank you, and let's move on.
Yeah, that's fair. I haven't heard good things, so yeah, we'll just leave that. So the Rejected.
You won't.
No, yeah, that's why we're not speaking about him. Let's not get any more. He can just fester in Dundee. So Dogs of War was after that. So before, like I said, you started, you were put with Brian Starr as the vet, the trainee. You've been approached with Mickey Vago, the fresh faced young upstart in Mickey Vago, to go with you as the veteran. Was it just again another just like going, yeah, we'll do this? So is tag team wrestling, did you find that was more your preferred output, or were you just happy to do it?
It just came out. Well, he'd had his first kid the year before, so he hadn't trained for a couple of months. So he'd kind of trained, was off for a while, and then he was only back a short time period, and then he got told, right, you're going with Archer. So my job was basically to kind of get him up to speed quite quick, which I didn't know the plan to Anarchy, obviously. You only basically half most of you only knew maybe a show or two in advance, maybe. So my job was basically just get him up to speed, get him to a stage where you wouldn't have to worry about going out there and things going wrong. And like I said, we were friends from mostly training together, because he's obviously, I think he said in your podcast before, when he started training, it was still the Scout Hut days, so you'd have the show guys, sort of main guys on a Wednesday, and sort of your new guys on a Sunday. And so he came in on the Sundays, and obviously his group, the people kept him dropping out, so he was moving group to group, and eventually he ends up on the Wednesday guys. But at the time, obviously, I was still going in both nights, so I'd be in for my night, and I would go in on a Sunday night, and the buffet go, and whoever was there at the time. So we naturally just got speaking, obviously, whatever it was, with he likes rock music, things like ours. We're both like, all different, similar sort of things. We just seem to naturally just kind of gravitate towards each other, just, which happens. You always have that certain sort of groups of people or just individual people you gravitate to. And then, fast forward to when he gets to sort of be on shows, I get to get him up speed as quick as you can without pushing too much. So I say first show in was the Cloverleaf, it was a Cloverleaf. So he comes in, does that, and then that was a ball rolling from there, and just each show was just they just get him just a little bit further ahead, and next thing you know, we're in a six man at Aberdeen Anarchy with next to a former WWE guy. So and obviously he held his own there, because he took to a lot of stuff quite quick. So it wasn't so much get him up to speed, it was kind of just be that little safety net there, if you know what I mean. Just he's got something to kind of fall back on. But he didn't really need me too much, because he just kind of picked things up quite quick. Well, we just seemed to click as a team quite well. I prefer tag team. I do like tag teamism more, but mostly because I've done it for that the last few years. It's a comfort. Yeah, you're kind of comfortable with it. You're kind of it's what you're used to. So now doing a singles sort of thing, it seems brand new, and even though I've done it before, it seems brand new. So but with Vago, everything was just so easy, just everything clicked, whether it was putting matches together or just speaking together before or after shows or coming up with ideas for things. So, you know, everything seems to just, you click naturally. So you didn't have to, you didn't kind of step over each other or things like that. You basically clicked just with everything that you did.
Nice balance between, like you say, you're teaching him how to get speed. And I think, again, from like mosh pits and my chats with him as well, is Vago's kind of your kind of balance. Like, you come up with a wild idea, he can go, maybe not that kind of thing. So you kind of balance each other out quite well. It wasn't a biker gang gimmick, though, was it?
I don't know how it kind of came about, because he would rock up shows and he would have the denim jacket on or the leather jacket, like the kind of off the cuts and that sort of thing, with his motorhead patches and things like that. So that just kind of that's what he was going to wear for his gear. So I changed my gear to match his. Mm-hmm. I thought, well, we're not going to go get leather jackets because everyone's doing leather jackets, or we're not going to do fancy jackets because everyone's doing that. I'll just get these cheap denim jackets. We'll get them on. They'll work. I thought, oh, we'll chuck patches on them just to make it actually look not just a denim, random denim jacket. And anyway, however, somebody must have shouted at us a show, hey, they bikers. And then we've not ever once made the reference that we are a biker gang. it just happens, the logo looks nice.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, that's it. That was like a weird thing when I didn't even notice it until, again, I think it was a mosh pit that Vago mentioned, but we've never said we're a biker gang. And I was like, oh yeah, no, neither you have. I've just always thought you were. Kind of thing, because, you know, the you hear the revving at the start, yeah, and all that kind of thing. It's just, it says biker gang, but no, you've never actually said that out loud, that you are. So that was kind of, I said, Vago said first match ended up with the Grado, and then the second match that you guys had as a team was again Aberdeen Anarchy, and again a marquee match because you're in the ring with the Thunder Buddies and, you know, Devon Dudley, just because. So again, I could ask how you got on with Devon, but I've heard he's very nice. More importantly, what was it like going through the table by Devon Dudley?
It was a bucket list thing. So I think it was one of those things that, like, you knew someone was going to go through at the end, and it regards whether what the outcome of the match was, you know, one of the three of us was going through, and I think everyone just kind of looked at me and go, it's you, is it? Which, at the time I was doing, I would have said yes to a bar, any sort of daft bump at the time. Not now, you know. It took me long enough to realise, but it's, at the time I was like, oh, I get put through a table by a WWE wrestler. I said, yes. So is it going to hurt? Probably, yes. But, you know, I remember watching, so I can't remember what they were trying to figure out what they were going to use, he's going to do to put me through, and they couldn't make their minds up.
So it was like one of those kind of, yeah, chipboard kind of things, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was. I think the tables you see on WWE and that, they're not readily available over here for whatever reason. I've only seen them a few places, so. We had them for Anarchy 2018. Well, I'll get that later on.
Yeah, just start on that one.
Sorry. sore point. But the table with you, whoever planted wood it was. And so he grabs me, and I think it's not a choke, so I can't remember the name of the move. So he just picks me up, and Devon being Devon, he could have picked me up with a one hand if he wanted to. I had no choice. I was going up with that one. But so he picks me up. He throws me through. And I think regardless how thick that or thin that table was, I was going through. So I went through, bang. And so it snapped just perfect. Because of the type of wood it was, it just the snap was that loud. They heard a couple of guys actually said they heard it backstage. This was a nice clean snap. So I go through and I'm lying there, and I didn't so much feel pain. I just felt searing heat, because obviously the ballroom lights were just shining on you. It's just wood. It's like, this is burning. And then obviously music plays, and next thing I know, I hear is Get out, kid, get out. Yep, okay, that's my cue. You don't argue with it with him. He says get out, you get out.
I still like that. I can't get that table out of my head because I think it was the Mick Foley show that year. They raffled it off two halves, and it still makes me laugh at the thought of someone having to take that home on the bus. It was just this half of a table that Devo Dudley put Chris Archer through, but still, you have to carry that home somehow. It's madness.
We're still in the bus.
I know, wee bit. So, what made you decide to change the name from Dogs of War to The Rejected?
Funnily enough, when we got put together, obviously, the song, the entrance theme got suggested, so I thought, yes, it's pretty cool, which, weirdly enough, I didn't actually gravitate to straight away. It kind of took me a couple of shows to kind of get used to it. But then, I can't quite sure what we were doing. I think it was, we'd wrestled the, I think it was the Granite State Hot Shots, we wrestled them as Dogs of War, and just, we were trying to say, everyone's trying to come up with this. This just doesn't work. It sounds like we're just basically just, we've copied the name off the song, we'll just use that. And somebody, I think somebody mentioned a promo or something, the word rejected and being rejected and this sort of thing. So that's pretty cool. That works. Well, that works the name. Or there's a few different sort of, actually, I think someone suggested the rejected. I can't remember, it might have been Vago himself, actually. And I thought, no, I think, yeah, that's cool. Let's go with that. And that works. And at least it wasn't just the name of the song we were using, because the name, I think I was just kind of given to us at times, so though we needed a name, you can't just come out as Art and Vega, you need a name. But after a couple of shows, the Dogs were just, it didn't click, it didn't sit in the ears well. Mm-hmm. But now here we are, what, 7-8 years later?
Yeah, it is. God. But no, it also kind of tied into your past as well as Outcast, and then moves into The Rejected. It kind of just all tied up nicely. So that leads us to your first title win then. So it would have been that year, I think, the year of you facing Devon Dudley with Looking Sharp and all that kind of stuff. So you finally won your first tag team titles, first title in WrestleZone with Vago. I don't know how much of a belt guy you are, if it's something that again was on your bucket list, but what was it like getting the nod and getting that first title win?
It was a struggle because we didn't actually know what was happening post Anarchy. You just took each show as it was, and then we go into the feud with Mr. P and Kieran Garrick, and obviously they were the tag team champions at the time. Oh, it's you, we're gonna have a fight with them, and obviously that season match we had with them, funnest ones I've had in the last how many years, matches I would love to do again. And so it comes time to the tag team title match. Actually, we find out what we're winning. That's pretty cool. And it's not sitting, I know some guys, oh, I want to win this belt. But I thought, if I stick at this long enough, I'll win a belt. I didn't want to be one of those guys that, oh, I've done this for this long and I've not won a belt. You know, well, I was here 11 years, and then I got my first singles belt. You know, so you'll get it when you get it. It's like, I've just never seen the point of being, like, I've heard of guys being like, oh, I've been here so many years, I've not won this belt, I really want to win this belt, I should win this belt. So you'll get it if you stick at it. So as that match comes about, we win the belt. And it wasn't until you actually come through and you sit down and you took that breath, you look, whew, it's pretty cool. Just say you're out there at the time, you're trying to take all this stuff in. It wasn't until you sit down, you stop, and thought, this is pretty cool. And to top it all off, I don't know if anyone, I think Vago might have mentioned the story already. So we go to do the match, we come back through, come through the curtain, and who do we see? Mick Foley, right there, as soon as you come through. Turns out, which we didn't realise at the time, he'd been sitting there the whole time from after Dave P and Kieran Garrick came out. He'd come through with a computer chair, sat down and watched the whole match. So he comes through, he says, oh, I thought that was a really good match, you guys enjoyed it. So that's good, cool. I said, yes, you're walking through, your adrenaline still goes. Did that just happen? So I say, this is a WWE guy saying, oh, great match, enjoy it. I say, you're going to take a compliment from him. Hmm. So he was in a separate dressing room. And I said, if you're wanting to go get a photo, I said, just go ask him. So we go ask, oh, Hey, may I go to get a photo? I said, yeah, sure, no, yeah, no worries. So I said, I'll just go, we go to get the photo. He said, no, bring the belts. So I said, I about turn, sprint out the room, so try to find the belts. So you run through this, it's not a wide course, you run through this narrow corridor, squeezing past bodies. So I'm lifting up, I was opening up the, I grab the belts, and I remember who someone said in the ear, says, what are you doing? He says, you're my shoulder. I said, make fully said to grab the belts, I'm grabbing the belts. So I sprint back through, and I think the photo is up there somewhere on Facebook. So me and Vago with Mick Foley with the belt. So I think somewhere I've got that. I think I've got that in a frame. But that's pretty cool.
I think I mind because I was at the other end of the hall. So but I was hearing. I think it was Kyle from the famed K&K Wrestle Factory. He said when he was there that he was seeing Foley just like his head just pop out every so often to watch that, and that's pretty cool, even though it's in Beach Leisure Centre, which is the coldest venue I've ever been in. No, second. Bucky's pretty bad. The Fisherman's Hall. Third, yep. Actually. Elgin's pretty shit as well. So, you know, there's a third worst, third coldest venue. But yeah, it was. I like that you get pictures with these big stars, because there's always this kind of a stigma on the interweb with wrestlers going, oh, don't be a mark, don't get a picture with other wrestlers. Why not? Like, why not? Just, you don't put them on Facebook, but Jesus, get a picture with these guys, because it's a moment. Get it.
A lot of these, there's a lot of guys that will have photos that you won't show because for whatever reasons, you'll have it for your personal questions. It's more so you look back and go, oh, I wrestled this guy, or I went to McDonald's with this guy. So that's another Dave P's probably too. So that he went to him and Mikey Ennis took X-Pac to McDonald's. So in his wrestling gear. You know, and I said, Mikey Ennis says he's been to Burger King that with Billy Gunn. You know, stories which you never think you would be telling. Mm-hmm. So, but I said, yeah, when I got a photo with X-Pac, photo with Devo, I said, you do it, because if I don't do it, I'm going to kick myself for not doing it. I said, I've wrestled this guy. No. I said, oh, it's cool, get us. So I'm not fussed with autographs. I said, just, I'll get a photo. So that's pretty cool. So, and a lot of times they're happy enough. As long as you go up and ask them, you're courteous, you're not being a pain in the neck about it, because some guys can be a bit funny also, but as long as you're not kind of pestering, you pick the right moment, because there is going to be, you'll have more, you know, I'll leave him, he's busy, I'm not going to pester him. Mm-hmm. Or if there's someone else to do it, you know, you give them a minute, you pick the right moment, because at the end of the day, they're just went there. They're 5 minutes themselves sometimes, you know.
Yeah.
They've got a job to do as well.
Exactly. I mean, like I said, for that kind of thing, when you're talking about like going to Burger King with Billy Gunn and that, it's like my favorite story I tell to people is like I took Colt Cabana and Sonjay Dutt to Subway. It's because I'm standing there, nobody knows these guys, and I'm standing there going, I am in Subway with Colt Cabana and Sonjay Dutt. This is mental to me. This is just craziness. And talk about the pictures as well. That was the reason why I got a picture with Drew when he came up to Inverness, because I was like, it was after a signing. He did the only signing. I got it just as he was finishing up. I was like, the reason is like, if I don't get this, I'm going to just hate myself. And then I think a year later, he ended up in back in NXT. And I was like, oh, thank God I got that picture at that point. Because
I think I was up with, I think Crusher on that show, maybe.
That sounds right, yeah.
I think I traveled up. I think I was backstage for that one. I remember I spoke to him and his wife backstage, and nicest guy in the world, but he is absolutely massive.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. That might be the second time, because I remember I was helping backstage with Rock and Wrestle, and I dropped off, I don't know, I think it was Rob Terry. I think he destroyed my wife's Clio because it was just sheer mass. But no, I ended up going backstage. And I just wandered through a door, and there he was with his wife. And I was like, oh my God, what are you doing here? He was like, oh, Jesus. But yeah, it's, yeah. I mean, I'm 5'10 and I'm still like towered over by Drew. Yeah, wrestling is just amazing when stuff like that happens. So during all that, first title win, you ended up making a debut down in Discovery. I did notice you had a couple of matches as a source as well, but I read who you were in the ring with. I thought, that wants to move on. So Discovery, though, you end up in one of their four ways with Michael Chase, I think it's Looking Sharp, and Aspen Faith as well. So again, new experience. What was it like getting down to Edinburgh for Discovery? Because their crowd's a bit different from WrestleZone. It's a bit more of that hybrid marquee, I suppose it would be the word for it. But it's that kind of crowd. What was it like getting the ring there?
It was different because at that point I'd been wrestling for 5 years, so you're just used to the one type of crowd. And it was actually through Aspen Faith that I actually got that. I was kind of thanks to him that kind of got that chance for Discovery. And we had the match. It's good. It was different because you're kind of your work. It was good in a way. You had one guy you'd worked with quite a lot in Aspen Faith, so kind of you knew at least one guy in the match. And obviously Looking Sharp as well, which I had a couple of matches with. So the match was I can't remember much of that match. I've not actually seen it back, but so we did the match, and I think I probably could have pursued getting booked down there again at the time, but it's just at the time, I think, for the reasons of outside the rest, obviously, just never did. Mm-hmm. But it was a good experience. It was different because you're used to one state type of crowd, but it was good to kind of work for a different audience. Again, you were back to almost square one because it's an audience that doesn't know you. So you get a chance to be a different person, be a different sort of character, and kind of almost start again. Mm-hmm. It's something I probably could have and probably should do pursue, which I've still got years left in me, so never say never.
Oh, you're still ridiculously young. It's like when we'll get to you win the Tri-Counties title, but I was telling my wife afterwards, like how old you were, or approximate, because I don't know the exact age, but approximate how old you were. She was like, what? Like kind of that you're like a good bit younger than her as well. And it's just like, how is he doing all that? And he's that young kind of thing. It's just ridiculous. Again, because she came into it and you're always there. You're always, Chris Harger's always on these shows. And it just baffles me how long you've been doing this. And we'll get into that singles title bit in a bit. Again, we'll kind of blast through some of these because you had your Aberdeen Anarchy 16 was, again, just in with these imports, these international talents. I don't know what your thoughts are on Bull James, but, we've got Bull James, the Hurricane, and Carlito. It wasn't the longest match in the world, but it was still quite a spectacle to see. Are you fine with Bull James?
I had very little dealings with the man. Because I experienced the good side and the bad side of him. Mm. But I think that match itself, weirdly enough, that wasn't supposed to be the original. That wasn't the original match, I don't think. I think Gredo was supposed to be slotted in there somewhere. It was supposed to be Hurricane, Carlito, and Gredo against Bo James and the Rejected. And I say maybe he would turn to us at the end, I think. I think that's what the plan was. And for whatever reason, plans changed. And it's now it's you guys and Looking Sharp against Hurricane, Carlito, and Bull Dempsey. You're pulling my leg again. This isn't real. So no, it's real. So I say again, okay, how do we put this together? And so you're in there with these guys. Hurricane, actually, he's not the tallest guy, but muscular. Carlito, ripped. Bull James, massive. But he was kind of, putting in the match together with him, and it was probably the longest I've ever took to put a match together with an outside talent. And he kind of had two sides. One minute he could be fine, and the next minute it was just, get away, I need to think, sort of thing. Cause I seen him snap at Looking Sharp. I was like, okay, I'm just going to stay clear.
Probably for the bit. Considering he's the least experienced out of three of them. But anyway, no, that's a vague old rant that you can have in our time. It's just weird. And then, of course, the year after was your titles versus hair match against Sterling Oil, which I adored. And I honestly didn't think it was going to go the way it did. That's why I love these matches, I love these shows. It's like I was determined that you guys were going to lose, which is obviously a jinx when it comes to WrestleZone, because my predictions are the worst ever. But no, that was, again, another fun match. Then we've got 2018, this tables match. Now, I've talked about this match enough for anyone to listen. I've had my rant about it. I've had my annoyance about it. It's fine. I've had Vago tell me that he specifically looked me out to stick it to me after they won. I'm okay with it. I'm over it. I'm not, but I will be for the sake of this. But no, when you're putting together a tables match, of course, you've got experience. You've been through a table. These tables, of course, were a little bit nicer.
Proper tables.
Did you feel the difference?
you did notice it, yeah, because it's just more your WWE type tables, if that makes sense.
Mm-hmm. Your classic style.
So I think for that one, obviously, for you're doing a match that you want all the toys to play with. And I think we'd try to get about six or eight tables, or how many we'd ask for. We got four. So I said, four we can make it work. So for whatever reason, we put everything together and we managed to work, we put things together, so everyone went through a table. I said, everyone knows I was going to go through a table. It was a foregone conclusion. Archer's going to do something like that. We know he is. We've known him long enough now. So comes our, I always remember my bump, because folk, and a lot of people thought I was just going to take a nice, easy, just bump to the floor. And I think Vago was supposed to take that bump originally, but I kind of volunteered myself. But as I do, so I took it, and for whatever reason, I had the Bubba Matt Hardy bump from Mania 17 in my head. I went to take that bump, and so I get pushed off, and I take the bump, and for whatever reason, this has happened to me a few times. I've taken a massive, scary-looking bump. They would probably look like it's killed me, and I've not felt a thing. I can't explain it. It's just the way it is. Because I remember Big Lewis at work security, he comes up to me, and he kind of gives me a little nudge. He says, "You all right?" I said, "Yeah, I'm fine." And weirdly enough, if you watch, I think it's Dodd Morris. If you look back at his, I think it's Dodd Morris. If you look back at that table bump, you can actually see a little Evan Young in the photo as Cesaro's go through the table. He's a little moment of fame.
Well, speaking of Evan, then he's put in a question. Evan, not as young as before, he's put a question in that. How many elbow drops does it take before it starts hurting you more than your opponent?
One.
Your elbow drop is like one of my favorites, though. So it's a very, like, I don't know if you did you pattern it off anyone in particular? Because, of course, you got your Randy Savage one, you get all that. For me, I think you've got more of a Shawn Michaels-esque kind of, like, the bit with it, like, he does it, like, kind of like it up yours as he goes down kind of thing.
Yeah.
So that was that kind of your, or was it just, that was just the way it happened kind of thing? That's how you did it.
I kind of stole it from Shawn Michaels. Did you watch it by? It just looked, visually, it just looked pretty cool. Because I did think of trying the Randy Savage, but the Randy Savage didn't have that showmanship about it.
Mm-hmm.
You're a bad guy at times, so you want to be that little kind of cocky guy. Like, what can I do? All these guys are doing those, these just fancy flips. I just want to do an elbow drop because it's an elbow drop. No one's doing it. I think only Damien was doing it at the time, but he obviously, I can't remember, he just has obviously a lot different to mine. I want to try and be different. I want to have my own sort of version. I watched the Shawn Michaels version. I like that one. I don't know why it was. There was just something about it. Obviously, more and more I did it, that's pretty cool. It's not hurting a lot. It looks pretty cool. But obviously, certain shows you would do, you would get a lot more height. And the height seemed to get more and more and more. So you had a lot more time to kind of do your sort of showmanship. And then you remembered about the landing. It's a move I've only ever missed once, and I will not miss again.
Fair enough. Yeah, so I was thinking, like, the height and that, of course, Beach Ballroom, nice and easy, big venue. Leisure Centre, big venue, excellent. Summerhill Hotel, not so much.
just enough room.
Just enough to do it. So I've got that, and then of course, yeah. I say I'm not getting into the table match because I've had my say too many times on it. What I will say though, you got me. All you's got me. Hook, line, and sinker. I had a wee cry. I was fine, but yeah, it's just you bastards was pretty much my reaction afterwards, because that's what makes wrestling good though. And it's just the reactions and the emotions.
That's what I enjoyed about that match, because you thought it was going one way. And we said, well, we'll take you this way, and then hook you, we're now going this way. And mm-hmm. It was obviously, you were getting that genuine reaction from people. So they thought, oh, boo, they've won, or yay, they won, depending who you were, who you wanted to win. And obviously, the end result was what it was. Which
So at that point, you brought in Caden Garrick to join the Rejected as a prospect. Again, was that a way to kind of branch out, maybe go on a bit of a singles run, or was it just a freshen up for the Rejected?
I think it was more of a freshen up, because we'd kind of done the duo for how many, five or how many years at that point. So I thought, well, what, bring in a third guy? And the original idea was sort of Spike Dudley, sort of a little person, young person, can do all the daft things. So that was the original idea. But everyone kind of thought we could use was kind of either already doing something or a way to be putting a show in some capacity. And so, like, who's not doing anything? And then Caden Garrick's name came up, and so we've been friends backstage since he came in. So we've always got on well backstage, and we thought this will work, because as soon as you bring him in, already there's that story between us, because obviously we'd had that rivalry over the tag team titles beforehand. I thought, you've got something that you can build on straight away. And obviously at the time he wasn't actually doing anything, he was just on a losing streak. So I thought, he's a guy, and eventually I thought, well, we'll build to it, so we'll do the prospect thing. He's got to earn it, and I say, at least to the sixth man at Halloween Hijinks, he gets his first win back, big win, but we're not going to let him straight away. So no, we'll make him work for it, and obviously, which led to the prospect thing, which led to the contendership for the leadership, which was still not resolved. So that whether that happens, we don't know.
Of course, then that was the point where the whole COVID happened, and that was the break of everything. So we'll jump to some questions then. As that kind of natural point of the career stops. No, that's Rolling King. We'll ask his one later. Let's go for Adam. Adam Morrison's the obvious question. How many bandanas is too many bandanas?
There is no such thing. I have a suitcase full, and it's getting fuller by the year.
So do you just is this a conscious thing where you order a batch of them, or you see them online, or do you just go places that sell them and go, oh, I'll pick one up while I'm here?
Yes, my first few were actually just gifts, random gifts from people. So, I bought one myself years ago, and then I've had a few from Martin Clues, because him being a music guy, he had heaps of bandanas, so he gave me a heap. And anytime I was in a shop or a place that was selling, I said, that's pretty cool, I'll buy that one. And I remember I was down south a couple of years ago in Whitby, where they do Dracula and all that kind of stuff. And I went to this little goth shop, wondering about, and I see this stack of bandanas. It's a pound each. So I'll have that one. So I basically just took the whole stack. That'll do it. £10, 10 bandanas. Not a problem. And the kind of collection's grown and grown and grown and still growing.
Yeah. We've also got Ryan Riley's then question to go with it, which there is. Because it kind of matches, goes with the bandana room kind of effect. He's put, hi Billy, if you will please. I love how polite he is with these questions. Could you ask Archer how it feels to have his own dressing room whilst at Haddo House? Thanks, Riley. So I have heard that you had a room just for yourself and your bandanas at Haddo House. But what was that kind of experience being sat? Did you know you had your own room, or did you go into the wrong room and decide this is mine now?
It was a strange, a funny one, because the room was like a proper hall we were in the grounds at Haddo House. So you went through into the backstage, and there was this little room off the side. Everyone's getting changed, and just there, I was crammed in. And naturally, like I do most big sort of like town halls and that, Dave Peel attests this, you go for a little wonder to see what rooms can I get into. So I said, wander around, found this set of stairs. I'll go down here. See this big, massive room. No one in here. Right, I'm scared to get changed here. And then I said, no one, for whatever reason, no one came near that room until later on in the day, try to find me. So, oh yeah, you're in a big league now, are you? Yep. Sitting there, everything just hung up. I said, why not? Why not?
Get a wee sign for the door as well, just with a star. Chris Archer.
Weirdly enough, that has happened at a show. I don't know who did it. But Summerhill showdown, I came into the room I was getting changed in to find a nice big star on the door. I wonder who.
I'm not saying that someone else on that show made a sign and put it in places, but I think we can guess who may have been using the printer funds that day.
Someone that's very good with Photoshop.
Yeah, exactly. So yeah, absolutely.
Is that still there?
I don't know. I don't use Photoshop. I refuse to pay for it. That's why my graphics are very poor. But you know, yeah. Vago. Right. So speaking of Vago, he's asked a couple questions in here. He's got ask Archer who is the Jannetty.
Oh, I think he knows. He knows. He knows.
I mean, you're the only one with a singles title win, so you know.
We'll just. Oh, that's true. Very true.
We'll leave.
Listen to that, Vago.
But I've still got a bone to pick with Vago for saying, "Oh, record this. Record. We're going to speak about an idea I've got for a future podcast. Can you record your reaction to it?" And then it was 3 minutes of just roasting me. So I've still got a little bit of a bone to pick with Vago. Part I recorded it was even worse. Just arsehole. And he's also put how it feels to have the second best moonsault in the rejected.
Well, I think he knows mine is better. I just don't do it enough.
Well, I mean, it's one of those moves. If you miss it, it's going to hurt a bit more than the elbow drop, I'm guessing. Just from watching it.
It hurts a lot less for some strange reason. Either I'm just built funny. I'm numb to it these days.
Well, I mean, if I keep hearing all these rumors about your knees being like 60 years old, it probably is at this point. You just don't feel the landing on them.
It's the best I've felt in years. Weird enough, at the point when COVID hit, I was just beat up. So I went and obviously got all this different stuff done, like sports massages, cryotherapy, and all this weird and wonderful shit. And weird enough, it's the best I've felt in years. But it's also made me realise I've got to stop doing as much daft stuff.
That's the thing with COVID. Yeah, it just seems to be that there's so many different things that people have done. Some idiots have done podcasts, some have done Twitch, but wrestlers, thankfully, have just taken that time to go, I'm going to have a rest. I'm going to just not do anything stupid. So, yeah, you spent COVID just rebuilding yourself one bit at a time.
Slowly, yeah.
Nice. The last question I've got, we've got Callum asking how much bandanas would a bandana if a bandana could bandana, but I think he was just trying to catch me out. So somehow I've pulled that off. Hopefully you don't cut out because I don't want to do that again.
I'm not trying to attempt it.
And last question I've got outside of our stupid ones is Blue Thunder. He's just asking, so how do you do a drop kick? So how do you do a super kick?
That was from a training session about 12 years ago. A certain wrestler, this guy, asked a daft question. And he got a daft answer. We'll say no more.
That's fair. Has anyone asked you in training since then that same question?
Like only to get not a trainee, but certain individuals, purely for the reason just to try and get a pop out of them. And every time it does.
So our silly questions that we ask everyone are just stupid, but people seem to like them. First up, what's your favorite dinosaur?
Ooh, Tyrannosaurus Rex.
Nice and classic.
Obvious, but...
That's right. It's a classic. Another one we ask is, who'd win in a fight, two sheep or one cow?
One cow.
Controversial. Yeah. And just off the top of your head, just no thought, or have you got a strategy in mind?
That's having a grandfather that was a farmer, so... Yes,
I like I've got over these all these conversations. I've had butchers, I've had people with farmers, and some just gut reactions. I still believe in the sheep. That's just on me. Right. So yeah, COVID happened. You got yourself rebuilt. What was it like getting back into training? Now you've done all these sports massages and cryogenics and things. It was just like. Water off duck's back, you're fine, ready to go again, or does it take a little bit of time to get used to the bumps again?
It was almost just like starting again, which is a strange thing to say, but because when we came back, it wasn't just the usual group of guys you were in with. It was you had your bubbles, and the bubble I was normally would have been with, like Vago and the usual guys I'd been in with, they already had their limit that they could have, so I got the choice of either one of these other nights. So I thought, I'll do this night. Actually, I don't know any of the guys, but it should be easy to kind of ease myself back into it. Didn't realise it was in with Evan Young and a certain other young wrestler, Ronan King. So I said, you're in there with two young guys. So first night back, I thought, no, I've picked the wrong night. But, so you're in there with them, and obviously they've got cardio that's way better than mine. They're 10 years younger, and they've not got as much mileage in terms of bumps and all the other daft things I've done. So I was always kind of step back and kind of slowly just build everything up again. Still not 100% there, but time will tell.
I mean, you're not bad in your first match back. So this would have been hijinks that you're back in, first match out. It wasn't the first match out, it was the main event. It was supposed to be the first match out, in the whole world of the show. But main event of your first show back, Halloween Hijinks against Captain Allen with the Tri-Counties Championship. Came in, obviously me being terrible at predictions, thinking, that's fine, nice, easy, nice, good, solid, great main event. Allen will just continue on his way. But no, he ended up winning the belt. The Tri-Counties title. Two questions. One, how did it feel getting the win the belt and getting your first match back? And two, were you aware that you're dressed like 2000 Undertaker?
Actually winning the belt, it was actually a bit of a shock, because you'd been there that long, and it wasn't actually until you get handed, it's like, this is pretty cool. But obviously, winning your belt, and obviously your first match back, main event, it's like, there's a lot of, actually going into that, like, there's a lot of pressure because you've been off for essentially nearly 2 years. So can I still go? Can I still do this? Can I do it the level I was doing it before? And by some miracle, we did. And to the second question, yes. Yes, good. I was fully aware. I was just waiting for someone to kind of click.
I mean, there's worse 2000s look for Undertaker. There was his Survivor Series one with the whole snakeskin leather gear, so you know you picked a good one.
I have been asked to do that look, believe it or not. There's certain individuals in the wrestling roster have asked me to do that look. I might or might not.
Avenue Anarchy soon. Avenue Anarchy soon. That's all I'm saying. That's just try to push the boat out. You know, every wrestler's got the WrestleMania gear for WrestleMania. I'm just saying, snakeskin for Avenue Anarchy. Why not?
The reason why I did it was I just wanted to change the look up. Mm-hmm. I thought, how can I change a denim look up? Put a denim shirt on. That's essentially it.
The old Canadian tuxedo
works for me.
But again, when you're doing a singles run now, and obviously Vago's doing it as well, and he's kind of mixed up his look. Even though he's putting all the pressure on a dungarees to make him look slimmer, but it's. You still got the same vibe look, but you're not the same. You're still individual, so it kind of works out that kind of way. You just spoke about Ronin. He's got a question, and he's going, how did you feel to see the amazing Ronin King? I don't think that's just amazing. I think it was something else. Ronin King, stomp your partner's head into the ground. So we'll say that. And also, what's it like seeing some of these younger guys come through now that the restart's begun?
Obviously, seeing Vega get stomped in is going to light a fire in there and want me to kick his ass as well. Which at some point will happen. But seeing the younger guys coming in, it makes you realize how old you actually are.
Right. You haven't reached your 30s yet. That's ridiculous.
I know. Well, in terms of wrestling, I'm a pensioner, mate. But, you see these guys coming in, and it puts that pressure on you. Because you see guys like Evan Young and all that, them coming in, doing what they're doing. Okay, lights that fire underneath you. So, well, if he can do this, I've got to be that just one step better.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but...
It's not so much in your time when you got into the core group was because one guy left, and now it's like everyone could be part of that core roster that goes to Bucky and all these ridiculous places that have stairs. It's making you a bit more, like you say, lighting a fire and making you make sure that you're keeping your place kind of thing by putting in the work to do so.
Yeah. See, it gives you fresh guys to work with as well, because your core sort of wrestling guys, we've all kind of wrestled each other countless times now. But so you do have got your occasional outside guys coming in, whether it be from Glasgow, Edinburgh, wherever guys are coming from. But the majority of your time is that sort of core, how many guys we have. But you're having these new guys coming in, it's different matches, different guys to work with. It gives them a different matches to have. Plus, it gives the guys that are kind of thinking they're either leaving or taking that step back the opportunity to do it. Because some of the guys are obviously thinking about it or thinking about maybe doing it come time. This is just giving them that opportunity or reason to do it, you know.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, because, of course, we've already seen, like, Blue Thunder's kind of taking a step back, and I think Scotty's not been quiet about he's not got much time left as well. So it's preparing these guys to fill in that void, and it's quite big shoes to fill, especially with what guys I've just mentioned as well. Ronnie King's going to get his arse kicked at some point. It's just who knows when. He'll make a TikTok about it, I'm sure. Right, so let's talk about Harvey Anarchy then. You mentioned like getting a chance with wrestling so many of the regulars, the core members of the roster, which as of recording you will be doing this weekend. You got a match with William Sterling, but as that, we don't know the outcome when this comes out. We'll just say you've won, move on, right? That's excellent. Just before, like an hour before we were set to record, your match for Harvey Anarchy was announced. This is May 14th. I think your guest Jackie Polo, and so Jackie Polo hasn't been in the Wrestle Zone since 2014. I think his last match was probably against Crusher during his title run, I think. So it's been a while. Of course, he's kind of evolved. He's not so much the TV. He's not TV's Jackie Polo anymore with the bleach blonde long hair. He's a bit more rugged, so to speak. So you've kind of got, I don't know if it's still the same, you don't find out your match until it goes up, the graphic goes up kind of thing, but I get fresh thoughts. What are your thoughts with that match being announced, and what's your kind of plans? Is it to watch back some Jackson Jackie Polo matches, or what's your reaction to it?
It's just saying straight, today was actually the first time I actually found out about it, because I didn't actually know who I was facing for Aberdeen Anarchy. So I was the same as you, literally maybe as I was walking back home to go record this, looks on my phone, notification from WrestleZone, Chris Archer versus Jackie Polo. Okay. It's going to be a fun match. I'm looking forward to it, because he's a guy I've only ever wrestled once, and even then that was a fatal four-way, so you had very limited interactions with him. But it's a match I'm looking forward to. I enjoy working outside guys, it's not your usual guys you can work with. It's fresh ideas. It's different. It's a different match. It's a match that's not been done. So I'm looking forward to what the outcome will be. We don't know what daft things I might do. We don't know. I don't know. I might do something I've not done before. I might not. Who knows? But it's definitely a match I'm looking forward to. It's a match I'll probably push. I would say push my limits to, well, probably past what they have been the last couple of months, you know.
But I mean, the Abriac, it's the one you're going to maybe do, do something a bit wild. If there's going to be a time you bust it out, this will be the kind of time.
Who knows what I'll do.
Excellent. So I've taken up so much of your time today, so we'll do some nice wee easy ones to round up. You said you mentioned your bucket list, winning title, going through a table, you know, that kind of stuff. Is there anything that immediate that you want to try and tick off, whether it's a heavyweight title, whether it's wrestling somewhere, particular wrestling somewhere? Have you got anything in mind that you want to accomplish in the short term?
I definitely want to wrestle a bit more out west wrestling before I do decide to stop, whenever that is. You know, whether it be regular or just the occasional joint to whatever. But definitely I want to probably pursue, maybe not this year, but once you kind of get back and straight things, once you get back to what sort of level where you're happy in terms of your performance and that, then I should try and branch out with. But definitely want to do that. Definitely would probably win a heavyweight title at some point, but who doesn't want to win one? But one of the things I definitely want to do, one of the things is definitely a cage match, a ladder match, and some sort of daft over 18s match, because I've not done them yet, and if I can get them, I'm happy.
I mean, this over 18s thing seems to be, I keep hearing this every so often, so I don't know if 2022, 2023 might be the year that, I don't know, we get another wild night out up in Aberdeen. Some sort. Well, hopefully 2023, because there's more chance I can get to it. Because, you know, I'm going to have to stop at Battle of Nations for an undetermined amount of time. I won't be able to go to shows. So, you know, leave it for the year after. That'd be grand. So, we'll do have another question here from Spyro. She's put, how does it feel knowing your girlfriend pulls off a bandana better than you do?
That's a good one. I think she'll find I pull it off just a little bit better. Just a little bit. I better watch what I say here.
Oh, right, it's fine. Just blink twice if you're in trouble. so yeah, we'll kind of wrap up there. Before we do, though, we do try and answer like a wee fancy question at the end, where you get to choose the main event of whatever match. So Vince McMahon's phoned you up. He's went, Chris Archer, we're putting you in the main event of WrestleMania, and we're letting you choose your opponent, the match type, opponents, so it could be a multi-man, it could be anything. You get to choose it, though. You book it. What would it be?
Now that is a question. If I did, I probably would do I would like to do a singles main event, but I would probably say it's, and again, it's probably been said by a few guys, but we'd like to wrestle Shawn Michaels before he cut his hair. I don't give a Shawn Michaels with short hair just doesn't work for me. But it would definitely be Shawn Michaels, just normal play, main event, but with Shawn Michaels, because the stuff I would probably be able to do, or the daft things you could do, and I think it'd be a fun match to do. Probably will never happen, but who wouldn't want to wrestle?
Fair enough. But no, that's it. Then we've accomplished it. We somehow got through with all the technical difficulties. We've made it to the end. We'll just wrap up there. So where can people find out more about Chris Archer, Rejected, anything you want to plug? Where can people find out more?
I've got a few pages. If you want Chris Archer, you got Facebook at Chris Archer, Twitter at Chris Archer 94, Instagram, I think, is just at Chris Archer. I've not done a TikTok yet, but I'm getting pressure to do one.
It's so hard.
Whether yeah. But you get the Rejected Facebook page as well. You got Mickey Vago, Facebook, Twitter. I don't think he's got Instagram yet.
I just realized I saw this, but how were you after one of the mosh pits that you got blazing up?
I don't remember much of that evening, funnily enough.
Fair enough. That's fine. we'll leave. I'm sure you'll be asked that in our time on when you get dragged back onto to Vagos. But no, thank you very much for taking the time to speak to me today.
Not a problem, sir. Thanks very much. Enjoyed it as always.